A very good morning to all of you. Today we will see what is the important thing that is required in the electronic circuit design. The main things that are required in the electronic circuit design are two things. The first thing is the analog and second one is the digital. Okay, so first we will see what is the digital system design and how it will be designed, what are all the circuits that are there which will be useful. Those things first we will see. So if you take digital system design, to learn this particular digital system design, we require some basic knowledge regarding some logic gates and how to construct circuit using logic gates, and after that how to reduce the size of that particular circuit, and after that in what applications we will use those circuits and where it will be used. So a sequence of things we will learn in this particular digital system design. To learn this particular digital system design, first we should know what are all the number systems that we are going to use. Generally all of us know that we are practicing from so many years, and we are well known to a particular number system. That number system is the decimal number system. This decimal number system is the well known number system, and this decimal number system consisting of values from 0 to 9. Combination of these is nothing but whatever number that we want. Suppose we want 25 is nothing but combination of two individual numbers. So the first number system is the decimal number system, and after that we have different number systems are there. The second number system I take as octal. So name itself indicating that octal means 8. So in this octal number system we have numbers from 0 to 7. So total 8 values will be there in the octal number system. And after that we have another number system, that is the hexadecimal. This hexadecimal number system consisting of values from 0 to 15. So that means the total length of the hexadecimal number system is 16. Total 16 values will be there. So and last one is the binary number system. This binary number system is very, very important to us, because based on this binary number system we are going to handle the system. System means here, suppose if I want to operate a computer or a digital circuit, the entire thing will depend on the numbers, binary number system. So this binary number system consisting of only two values, those are 0 and 1. So 0 will be considered as one bit and 1 will be considered as another bit. Okay, so these are the number systems that are available, starting with the decimal number system, which consisting of values from 0 to 9, octal number system, values from 0 to 7, hexadecimal number system, values from 0 to 15, binary number system from 0 to 1. So after knowing the number systems of different types, starting with decimal, next octal, next binary, next hexadecimal, all, after knowing all this, we will see what numbers comes under this category. Just we observed that decimal. So decimal number system consisting of 0 to 9, values from 0 to 9, and octal consisting of 0 to 7, and next hexa consisting of 0 to 15, and last one binary, it consisting of values 0 and 1, two numbers. If you want to take a tabular form for comparison of, so what are all the decimal number systems, what are all the octal number systems, what is hexadecimal, what is binary, if you want to take that, I will take a simple table here to show the difference between these number systems. I am starting with the decimal, next octal, next hexa, and next binary. So decimal number system, already I told, it consisting of values from 0 to 9. So 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, like that this number system will follow. And next octal number system, already I told that this octal number system consisting of 8 values starting with 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So this is the big value in the octal number system, maximum value 7, and after that 2 digit values will start. That means next value will be 10. So if I am not keeping any value here, that means that it is carrying 0 here on the left side. Now after 7 I am giving 2 digit value, that is 10. Like that this will be continued, 11 12 13, like that this value will be continued. This will end at 17, and after that 20 will start. So octal number system will be like this. Suppose if you take hexadecimal number system, the values will be like this: 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Up to 9 it is like a decimal number system, but after 9, next value will be A, next will be B, next is C. So like that this will be continued up to F. If you take 0 to F, the total numbers will be 15, and next one is the binary number system. In the binary number system, we will start with 0 and next value is 1, only 2 values will be there. But if you take these two in single bit, 0 and 1, only 2 values will be there. If I go with double digit, double bits, then it will be next 10 11, and if I go with other next number, I will get 100 101 110 111. If I go with 4 bits, this will be 10 00 10 01, like that. So it will be like up to 1111, and after 4 bits we will get 5th bit. So if you take a comparison of decimal, octal, hexadecimal and binary, it will look like this. So after knowing the basic number systems and how they will look like, and equivalent values in one format to another format, next we will see how to convert this one format to another format. So generally, suppose if you want to convert any decimal number into, for example, into binary, a decimal value is taken. If you want to convert that into binary, first we will take a decimal value. Suppose a decimal value I am taking 24. So to indicate that this is decimal, a base value I am writing here, that is 10. 24 is the decimal value. Now I will convert this number into a binary equivalent value. How to do this? To do this, first take that number 24 decimal value and divide this number with 2. If you divide this number with 2, you will get remainder as well as quotient and remainder. You will get this, can this will be continued like this. So 1 cannot be divided with 2, that's why I am stopping here. Now after doing this, if you want to take the binary equivalent value of 24, so what we have to do is we have to take value from this side to this side in this order. It will be like this: first value is 1, next value is 1, next value is 0, next value is 0, next value is 0. So this is the binary equivalent value of decimal value number 24. If you want to verify whatever thing that was given here, you need not to accept this unless you verify whether this is correct or not. How to verify? If you convert this number back into decimal, if you got 24, then you can believe this. So how it will be done? So the number that we got here is 11 000, which is a binary value. If you want to convert this number back into decimal, what you have to do is you have to start from this location, this side. So this side value we call as LSB, least significant bit, and this side value we call as MSB, most significant bit. So I will take from this value. So first I will take this bit, LSB bit, 0 into power values I will take 2 power 0, and this value is 0 into 2 power 1 plus next value 0 into 2 power 2 plus 1 into 2 power 3 plus 1 into 2 power 4. That means this weight is 0 × 2^0, x 0 × 2^1, 0 × 2^2, 1 × 2^3, 1 × 2^4. So if you do this, these values will be 0, and this is 8, and this is 16. 8 + 16, that number is 24. So that means a decimal value is converted into binary, and that binary value is taken and converted back to decimal. So we got 24 here. So that means whatever process that we have done, that is correct. So this is the way of converting decimal to binary. Just we have observed decimal to binary and binary to decimal. Next we will see, suppose if a octal value is given to you, an octal number is given, and how to convert this octal number into some binary, or binary value is given to you and how to convert this into octal. So this is a very simple process, very easy. I will give a simple shortcut. Suppose I have a binary value like this. If I want to convert this binary value into octal, the simple logic is, already I told that binary consisting of base 2 and octal consisting of base 8. So if you want to get 8, value 8, so if you take this formula, 2^n is equal to 8, by placing which value you will get 8, suppose 2^1, no, 2^2, no, 2^3, 2^3 equal to 8, that means n value is 3. That means you require 3 bits to represent this octal value. So for that what I will do is, to convert binary into octal, I will start from this side. Already I told that this side is the LSB side and this side is the MSB side. So I will start from this point. From this point I will take 3 bits and I will take that as a group, because 8 is the octal, octal means 8. 8 you will get because of 2^n. In here n is nothing but 3. If you place 3, then you will get 8. So that's why 3 bits, binary value of 3 bits I am taking as one group. Next 3 bits, next 3 bits. Now what I will do is, I will convert this into not. So 100. So 100 means this value is 4. 010, that means 2. 110 means 6. So finally, the binary equivalent value, the octal equivalent value of this binary is 426 with base 8. So this is the way of converting a binary value into octal. The logic is very simple. Take the binary, divide 3 bits, start from LSB side, and after that just simply convert. So this is the way of converting binary to octal. Similarly, we can do octal to binary also. Suppose I will take an octal number, an octal number with base 8. So if I want to convert this into octal, so the same process will be applied here, reverse process. So 3, represent 3 in 3 bit binary value, that means 3 equivalent values if you take for these. If you convert this into binary, then 3 is nothing but 011, and 6 is nothing but 110, and 5 is nothing but 101. So it is very easy to convert a particular octal value into binary, as well as binary value into octal. So binary to octal and octal to binary is depending on a simple formula, 2^n. If you represent 2^n, if you properly understand the 2^n, so with respect to that n value, you can do this process. So next, after knowing how to do decimal to binary, binary to decimal, octal to binary, and binary to octal, and all this, next we will see how to convert hexadecimal to binary and binary to hexadecimal. So first we will see hexadecimal to binary, and after that we will see how to convert binary to hexa. First I will take an hexadecimal number. Hexadecimal number I will take here, some number I am taking, 8A, some B, and some 6. For example, this number I am taking as an hexadecimal number. To convert this number into a binary, logic is very simple. If you understand properly the table which was given to you regarding hexadecimal values, binary values, octal values, decimal values, simply represent these represent each number, each digit, into its binary equivalent. So how it will be done? 8 means we know that this is 1000. A means 1010. B means 1011. and 6 means 0110. So I am writing it very simple, but if you want to know what is the value of A, what is the value of B with respect to the binary, so whatever table that was given to you earlier, if you follow that reference, then it is very, very easy to convert. You should remember that particular table, then only you can do this process very easily. And similarly, if I want to do binary to this hexadecimal, binary to hexadecimal, I will take a binary value, some number. I am taking this particular number, binary number. Now I will convert this binary into hexadecimal. So in the conversion of binary to octal, what we have done is, in the binary to octal, three values, three bits has taken one group. In the hexadecimal, the same thing will be taken here, but here the number of bits are not three, here the number of bits are four. So I will start from this side, because this is LSB, 1, 2, 3, 4. These four bits as one group, 1, 2, 3, 4. These four bits as one group, 1, 2, 3, 4. These four bits are one group. Here only a single bit is there, 0. So the remaining bits are nothing but 0 only. So now we will convert this number into its hexadecimal value. So if you look at this, 4 zeros, it is nothing but 0. So 1101. So we know that A is nothing but 1010 and B is nothing but 1011 plus 1 of that. C is nothing but 1100 and D is nothing but 1101. And E is nothing but 1000 and F is nothing but 1111. So this is the values of hexadecimal and binary equivalent values. So according to this, now look at here, 1101. 1101 is nothing but D. This is D. Similarly, 0101. So 101 is nothing but, this value is 5. 1011. So 1011 means this value is B. So if you want to convert a binary value into its hexadecimal value, if you know the binary values as well as its hexadecimal values up to 15, then you can convert any number, any big number into any big binary value into its equivalent hexadecimal value. So this is the way of converting binary to hexa and hexa to binary. So after knowing these numbers, how to convert from one format to another format and all these, next we will go to the application, some of the applications. Before going to the applications, first we should know what are all the elements that will be used in the construction of the circuit, because whatever circuit you are going to construct, that circuit will be utilized for a particular application. For example, if you want to construct a simple circuit for addition, a simple adder, so how it will be constructed. So to construct a simple adder, you require some basic elements. So in digital circuit design, in digital system design, the main elements to construct any circuit is the gates. Okay, so now I will introduce different gates and their logic operation of those gates. And once we know what are all the gates we have and what is the logic of that gate, then automatically we can use that a particular gate at a particular application. Depending on the application, we can use them. So gates are nothing but a logic producing circuit. That means a gate is a device which will produce a particular logic. For example, different logics you can take. Suppose addition is one particular logic. Similarly, multiplication is one logic, or negation is one logic, complement is one logic. Like that, different logics will be there. Though logic, if you want to implement, you require a basic element, that is gate. So then we will get a question that, so how it will be constructed, gate? So gate is nothing but by using some combination of transistors, resistors, and some components, we will construct that. A gate is also, it seems to be like a digital circuit, but it is nothing but an analog combination internally. But once we combine that, we will get a module. That module we are calling as gate. So if you take the gates, we have basically, we have total 7 gates are there. I am starting with the first gate. The first gate is the AND gate. A and D. This AND gate will do the operation of logical multiplication. This will do logic multiplication, and symbol for this AND gate is, mathematical symbol is AND. And if you want to represent this AND gate in logical way, logical representation, the symbol will look like this. The symbolic representation of AND gate is this. So which consisting of two inputs, one output. So here inputs, I have taken minimum two inputs because it is doing multiplication. To do multiplication, at least we require two inputs. That's why two inputs are taken. It doesn't mean that only two inputs will be there. You can take n number of inputs, but whatever inputs you are giving, all will be multiplied logically. So and it will produce the output at C. So this is the first gate we have, that is AND gate. And next we have the OR gate, second gate. So this OR gate will do logical addition. And this is the symbol for the OR gate and mathematical expression wise. And next, symbol wise, logic symbol wise, this is the symbol for the OR gate. So if you take inputs A and B and output as C, so addition between A and B will be performed, logical addition, and output you will get at C. This is the second gate that we have. And next, the third gate is the NOT gate. So this gate will do the complement operation. Complement is like this. Complement is nothing but, suppose in digital, in binary, we are having only two bits, either 0 or 1. If you apply 0 to this NOT gate, output is complement. That means output is 1. Suppose if you apply 1 as input, output is nothing but 0. That means opposite value it will produce at the output. So that's why NOT gate, that's why we are calling this as a complement operation. So if you take the symbol of this NOT gate, NOT gate symbol will look like this. So A is input and A bar is the output. If you take mathematical symbol of this particular, so this is the symbol for that. Logical symbol, we cannot call this as a mathematical, logical symbol is this. And is the symbol for the AND gate, and this is the symbol for the OR gate. And these three gates, whatever I have given to you, these three gates we call as basic gates. After these basic gates, the next gate is the NAND gate. So if you look at the term of this particular NAND gate, so AND symbol is projecting here, and this first N letter stands for NOT, and these three letters will stand for AND. So that is nothing but, it is the combination of NOT gate as well as AND gate. So if you take the symbol of this, so first we have to take an AND gate, and at the output side we have to put a bubble. So this bubble indicates a NOT gate operation. So if you give A, B as inputs, output is C, and here the expression is C is nothing but, what it will do is, it will do the multiplication between A and B. So that means AB will be multiplied logically, and after that a complement will be performed on that. So the expression is C is equal to AB whole bar. Here also we can take the expressions. It is nothing but AND gate expression is AB only, and OR gate expression will be like this, A plus B operation, and it is the complement operation for the NOT gate. So if you take the NAND gate, NAND gate is combination of AND gate as well as NOT gate. Similarly, if you take another gate, that is NOR gate, so NOR gate will look like this. First it will look like OR gate, and at the output it is having a bubble. So inputs are AB, and if you take output as C, C is nothing but, first it will do addition operation, after that complement operation, A plus B whole bar. And next gate is the XOR gate. This NAND gate and NOR gate we call as universal gates. Why? Because if you have NAND gate and NOR gate, whatever logic that can be implemented with AND gate, OR gate, NOT gate, that we can construct using these two gates. That means if these gates are not available, no problem. If NAND and NOR is there, we can have this logic through these gates. Not only these three gates logic, I'm going to discuss two more gates. Those gates also can be constructed using NAND and NOR. That's why we call these gates as universal gates. So if you take XOR gate, the XOR gate symbol will be like this. A, B as inputs. Output is nothing but C is equal to A plus circle B. The meaning is AB bar plus A bar B. So that means first a multiplication will be performed between A and B bar, and after that A bar and B, after that these two will be added. So this is the XOR gate, another gate, and last gate is the XNOR gate. So XNOR gate is nothing but XOR gate with NOT gate. So it will look like this. So here expression, output expression C is nothing but A dot circle B. So that means A bar B bar plus AB. The expression is this. So these are the gates that we are having, starting with AND gate for logical multiplication, OR gate for logical addition, NOT gate for complement operation, NAND gate with combination of AND and NOT, NOR gate with combination of OR and NOT, XOR and XNOR, two gates. These are two special gates. Generally these XOR gate will be used in the comparison operation. Whenever you want to compare two things, then it can be used XOR gate. In some cases we will use XNOR gate. So these two gates are special gates. So totally we have 7 gates. 3 gates comes under basic gates, 2 gates comes under universal gates, 2 gates comes under special gates. So far just we learned how to construct a combinational logic circuit. A combinational logic circuit is a circuit which can be constructed with only gates. If you want to construct a circuit, if you are using gates in that circuit, we call that as a combinational logic circuit. And in the combinational logic circuit, whatever output you are getting, that is because of the present input that you are applying. Suppose if you apply input, corresponding output you will get. Corresponding to that input, output you will get. On the other hand, we have another kind of circuits, we call it as sequential logic circuits. The sequential logic circuits will be like this. A sequential logic circuit consisting of combinational logic circuit, that means gates based things will be there, and along with that it consisting of memory also. Sequential logic circuit consisting of combinational logic circuit part as well as memory, and some feedback will be there. So we have two categories, combinational and sequential, two types, combinational and sequential. Under combinational logic circuits, so many circuits are there. Suppose starting with simple adder circuit, adder itself we have half adder, full adder like that, and we have half subtractor. And we have full subtractor, and so many combinational logic circuits we have, like multiplexer, demultiplexer, and some code converters. The code converters, so many code converters and decoders, encoders, all these, whatever things I am showing here, all these things will comes under combinational logic circuit. Combinational logic circuits, we have half adders, full adder, half subtractor, full subtractor, multiplier, multiplexer, demultiplexer, code converter, decoder, encoder, etc. All these will comes under combinational logic, and in all these circuits we are going to use gates, only gates. And along with this combinational logic circuits, we have sequential logic circuits also. In sequential logic circuit, just I mentioned that this consisting of gates as well as the memory, and in some cases feedback. So sequential logic circuits, examples if you want to take, flip-flops. This will comes under sequential, and we have some devices, counters and registers, some sequence generators, etc. So we have two types of circuits in digital, combinational and sequential. Under combinational, these things will come. Under sequential, these are the some of the things are given here: flip-flops, counters, resistors, sequence generators. So just we have seen what are all the things that comes under sequential, what things will comes under the combinational. Now in the sequential logic circuits, I have given some examples like flip-flops, counters, resistors, and sequence generators like that. Now we will see how to construct the counter. Okay. First of all, we should know what is meant by counter. A counter is a device which will count number of events that you are doing or number of operations that you are doing. A device is required to count number of operations. In this can be taken in another way. In counter, generally what we will do is we count the number of clock pulses we are applying. So a counter is a device which will count number of events and which will count number of operations that you are going to do, because this is very important to know. So how many things that are happening in a particular operation, how many things that are happening. Or suppose simple thing, suppose I want to allow 10 members, so I have to count number 1, 2, 3, 4, like that I have to count, and whenever I reach to that particular count, then I will know that, so whatever thing that is required, that is fulfilled. So this counter will provide this required operation. So if you want to construct any counter circuit, these counters are classified into two categories. So the first category is the asynchronous counter, and the second category is the synchronous counter. So counters are divided into two types: first category asynchronous, second category synchronous. So asynchronous, synchronous, what is the difference between these two? The asynchronous counter is a counter which will be constructed like this. Suppose if I take a flip-flop, if I take two flip-flops here, the output of the first flip-flop is connected as clock to the next flip-flop. This type of connection we call as asynchronous type. So that means this flip-flop will be derived based on the output of the previous flip-flop. Similarly, if I take one more flip-flop here, the third flip-flop will get output, will get the clock pulse from output of the second flip-flop. If the connection is like this in the clock pulse, this type of things we call as a asynchronous. These counters we call as asynchronous counters. On the other hand, we have synchronous. In the synchronous, the clock pulse, whatever clock pulse that you are going to connect, that clock pulse will be connected in a sequential way, in a synchronous way. That means, just look at here, two flip-flops are taken, first flip-flop clock pulse, second flip-flop clock pulse, both are connected to a common point. That means if I apply clock pulse here, that clock pulse will go to the first flip-flop as well as to the second flip-flop at same time. And if you look at the asynchronous counter, here asynchronous counter, you are applying clock pulse to the first flip-flop, but for the second flip-flop, the clock pulse you are getting from the first flip-flop output. Similarly, for third flip-flop, you are getting clock pulse from the second flip-flop output. If this is the case, we call these counters as asynchronous counters. If clock pulse is given in this way, we call these as a synchronous counters. Asynchronous counters, each flip-flop will depends upon the previous flip-flop output. But here the clock pulses are independent. So if you apply clock pulse here, that clock pulse will go to all flip-flops at the same time. Asynchronous as well as synchronous, two types of counters. Now we will see how to construct asynchronous and how to construct synchronous counters. In asynchronous counters, so what is the way to construct? In synchronous counter, what is the way to construct? These things we will see. So now we will see how to construct an asynchronous counter. Asynchronous counter, we call it as a ripple counter also. So asynchronous counter, the construction of asynchronous counter is very, very easy when compared with the synchronous counter. Why? Because in asynchronous counter, just we have to follow a particular procedure, simple procedure, to construct any type of counter. That may be up counter, that may be down counter, or that may be a mod counter. For example, if you want to construct a asynchronous counter, for example, I am taking up counter. The up counter means it counts starting with value 0, slowly increments next to 1, plus 1 increment, next 2, 3, 4, like that. Every time it will be incremented by 1. That counter we call as a up counter. For example, if you want to construct a counter for a particular number, so then how many flip-flops we have to take, how to proceed, for that we have to remember this particular formula 2 power n. So depending on the n value, the number of flip-flops will be taken. For example, suppose I want to construct a counter which will starts at 0, 0, 0, 0, that means 0, and it will increment and reach to the maximum value 1, 1, 1, 1 in 4 bits. So that means between 0, 0, 0, 0 to 1, 1, 1, 1, we have total of 16 values. So how we will get 16 using 2 power n? If I place n value is equal to 4, then 2 power 4 equal to 16. That means if I keep n value 4, then I can take values up to 16. I can count up to 16 combination. So here in the construction of the asynchronous counter or up counter, for this sequence, I am taking n value 4. N value means nothing but number of flip-flops. Here I am taking 4 flip-flops. I have taken 4 flip-flops here because n value is equal to 4 to have count from 4 zeros to 4 1, total 16 values. So here I am taking all JK flip-flops. So 4 JK flip-flops are taken. So already we know that JK flip-flops will work like this. If the input for the JK is 0, 0, J is equal to 0, K is equal to 0, then Q and Q bar values, the state we take as no change. That means if earlier value is 0 for the output value Q, the next value also will be 0. That means no change in the output. Suppose if you take 0, 1, 0, 1, then output is 0. Then output is 0. And when you take, we will take this as a Q bar because we are discussing with JK flip-flop, so I will show what is Q and Q bar. No change means next value will not change. If present value is Q, next value will not change. If 0, 1 is given as input for JK, output is Q. So obviously, Q bar value will be 1. And for this case, next case, if I apply 1, 0, then output will be 1 and Q bar value will be 0. The last case, when I apply 1, 1 here as input for JK, then output will be in the toggle mode. The meaning of this is, suppose if I apply 1, 1, first time if the output is showing 0, next time by applying clock with keeping the same input, the value will be complemented. That means if earlier value is 0, next value will become 1. If earlier value is 1, by applying clock pulse, next value will become 1. So 1 will be converted to 0, 0 will be converted to 1 by applying clock pulses without changing the input. This state we call as toggle. So now I am going to use JK flip-flop in the toggle mode. That means I will short J and K terminals of all the flip-flops and I will connect all these JK shorted lines to a common point and here I will apply logic 1. That means if I apply logic 1, the first flip flop is getting 1 1 as input, second flip flop getting 1 1, third flip flop getting 1 1, fourth flip flop is also getting 1. Okay, already I told that I am going to construct asynchronous counter. So first flip flop will get the clock pulse, first flip flop will get the clock pulse, and second flip flop will get the clock pulse from the output of the first flip-flop, and third flip-flop is getting clock pulse from the output of the second flip flop. Here I am taking negative triggering. So for first flip flop only I will apply clock pulse. So that means when I apply clock pulse here, the first flip flop will get the clock pulse, and depending on the output of the first flip flop, the next flip flop we can drive. Similarly, depending on the output of the second flip flop, third flip flop you can drive. So this is the arrangement. And JK flip flop consisting of one more important line, that line we call as a clear. Generally this is clear bar. That means whenever I apply a value here, whenever I want to clear the contents of the JK flip flop, I can use this line. If I apply 0 to this line, a bubble is there, that means 0 bar is 1, clear will be activated. That means the flip flop, all the contents in the flip flop will be clear. So I will take clear signal at 4 flip flops, and initially I will connect this to logic 1. That means if 1 is applied, bubble is there, so internally 0 will go. So that means contents will not be cleared at the starting. Suppose if you want to clear the contents, you can utilize this particular line, clear line. Now this is the construction of asynchronous counter. Now we will see the operation of this asynchronous counter. So first time what we will do, first we will apply the clock pulse here. So by applying clock pulse, what happens? We are applying 1-1 at the input, so it will be toggled. So initially the Q1, Q2, Q3, Q4. So I am taking here Q4, Q3, Q2, Q1, LSB to MSB. So first time the values will be 0, 0, 0 and Q1 is 0. Whenever this Q1 is 0, so next time it will drive the next flip flop. So by applying logic 1, so first time the values will be like this, and by keeping the logic 1, if I give another clock pulse, then it will be toggled. So the earlier, suppose Q1 value is 0, now it will become 1. So this will become 1. So 1 is arriving here, so it will not drive. So 0, 0, 0. That means the next value will be 0, 0, 0, 1. Similarly, by applying next clock pulse, every time Q1 value will be toggled. But whenever this value is 0, then only it can drive the next, because negative triggering is using here. So next value will be, so this value will become 0, so this 1 will be there here, and 0, 0, 1, 0, next level. Similarly, when I apply another clock pulse, this 0 will become 1, so 0 is there, so it will not, this value will not change. So this also 1, 0, 0. For next clock, this will be 0, 1, 0, 0. Next 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1, 1, 0. Like that, it will be continued, it will come up to 1, 1, 1, 1. Whenever all the outputs become 1, 1, 1, 1, if I apply another clock pulse here, this will become 0. Automatically it will drive this. This flip flop also will be toggled. This flip flop also will be toggled. This flip flop also will be toggled. So automatically, obviously, again we will come to 0, 0, 0, 0. So this is the way of constructing up counter and to verify how it is working. So in the up counter, we have taken this arrangement and we are applying clock pulses. We started with 0, 0, 0, 0 as output, and slowly it is incremented step by step 1, and finally it reaches to 1, 1, 1, 1. If you give another clock pulse, again it starts from 0, 0, 0, 0. So this is the way of constructing an asynchronous counter of up counter. Okay, asynchronous counter, just we constructed up counter. Now we will see how to construct a down counter. To construct a down counter, to construct a down counter, only a small modification we have to do in the earlier circuit. That means earlier we have taken actual output of flip flop and connected to the clock pulse to the next flip flop. But here what we will do is, instead of taking actual output, we will take complemented value of the output and we will connect that to the clock pulse of the next flip flop. Similarly, complement value of the second flip flop, complement output value of the second flip flop will be connected to the clock pulse of third, and complement value of third flip flop will be connected as clock to the next flip flop. So the arrangement will be like this. So just only a small change. Instead of connecting from Q1, here we connected from Q1 bar. Instead of from Q2, Q2 bar. Instead of from Q3, Q3 bar. So that is the final one. So we can collect the outputs from Q1, Q2, Q3, and Q4. So when we apply clock pulse here, initially the values will be 0, 0, 0, 0. Initially the value will be 0, 0, 0. But by applying one more clock pulse here, because once it became 0, the Q1 bar value will become 1. So that 1 will come here. So for the next clock pulse, this value will become 1111. Once this value become 1111, and by applying next clock pulse, just look at here, I am applying clock pulse. Every time Q1 value will alter, because it is getting the clock pulse directly and it works in the toggle mode. But depending on the output of the Q1 bar, Q2 bar and Q3 bar, next subsequent flip flops will work. So in the next case, what happens? So this will be 111 and this will be 0. That means this is number 15. So next it will become number 14. Next value will be 13. Next value will be 12. Next value will be 11. So like that, it will be decremented and it will reach it to value 0000. And after this value, if you give one more clock pulse, next again it will become 1111 and the same sequence will be repeated. So this way of constructing things we call as a down counter construction, asynchronous down counter. So that is the table for that. So just we have observed how to construct asynchronous up counter as well as down counter, two counters we construct. Now the problem in these counters is, suppose if I take four flip-flops, my counting value will start from 0, 0, 0, 0 and ends at 1, 1, 1, 1. I cannot stop my counter at the middle. That means actually I want to count only 10 numbers, 10 values. But if I take 4 bits, my counter starts counting from 0 and ends at 15. That means total 16 values it will count. If I want to stop my counter, then instead of taking circuit like this, what we will do is, we will slightly modify that circuit. A small simple logic is there. If you use that logic, we can construct counter of any number. That means if I want to construct counter of 10, I can construct. Counter of 20, I can construct. Counter of 50, I can construct. Any counter I can construct. So now we will see how to construct a mod counter, asynchronous mod counter. For example, I am taking mod 10. So that means my counter will start at 0, ends at value 9, 0 to 9, total 10 values it will count, after that it will become 0. To have this particular counter, first take JK flip-flops, even though you are designing counter of mod 10, so 10 is more than 8, so 2 power 3 equal to 8 and 2 power 4 equal to 16. So you have to take 4 flip-flops, n value is equal to 4, and I am taking JK. So the circuit construction is almost similar to the up counter construction. So that means J and K will be shorted and connected to a common point. J and K will be shorted and connected to a common point for all the flip-flops. And this will be connected to logic 1. That means all the flip-flops are going to work in the toggle mode. And next, the clock pulse will be connected to the first flip-flop in a normal way. But from second flip-flop onwards, we will take clock pulse from the previous flip-flop output. Okay, so this is the up counter construction, we know this. So once I give the clock pulse, what happens also we know. The counter start counting values from 4 zeros and slowly increments every time. But here a simple logic we will follow. That logic is, we want to stop counter at 10. That means whenever counter reaches to that particular value, 10, automatically the contents of the flip-flop should be cleared. That means it should count again starting from 0. To do that, we will use the signal clear. the flip flops consisting of one particular line, that line is clear. This clear line will be utilized properly. This clear line will be utilized properly. So what we will do is, whenever this flip flop gets the clear signal, automatically the contents will be arranged. Automatically the contents will be arranged. When this clear will get that I am shorting all the clear signals of all the flip flops. Suppose I want to construct counter for mod 10, that means I will take the binary equivalent of 10. So if I want to have binary equivalent of value 10, decimal value 10, so it is 5 0 2 1 1 0. So binary equivalent of 10 is nothing but 1 0 1 0. So that means whenever this counter output becomes one zero one zero, automatically the counter should be cleared. So here, for this particular logic, we are using a NAND gate here. The operation is very simple. Whenever I want to clear the flip flops, the clear signal here I have to apply value 0. So that means when NAND gate will become 0, output will become 0. When both the inputs become 1, when both the inputs become 1, the output of the NAND gate will become 0. So I will use that particular thing. So suppose if I generate from this particular counter 1010, whenever it reaches to 1010, so I will take this Q4, Q3, Q2, Q1. So this should be 1010. That means Q4 value and Q2 value, whenever Q4 and Q2 both become 1, then the output of the NAND gate I will make 0. Because if I connect Q4 and Q2 to NAND gate, then only output will become 0. That means number 10 is this. So what I will do is, so Q4 and Q2, that means this is Q1, this is Q2, this is Q3, this is Q4. So this Q4, whatever Q4 I have, I will take this Q4 and I will take Q2 also. These two I will connect to NAND gate and output of the NAND gate will be connected to this. So now what I will do is, I will start giving the clock pulses. So value starts with 0000 and it will go up to 1001. So every time I will check whether this NAND gate is producing 0 or not. So every time what happens, what lines we connected here? Q2, Q1. Every time both Q4 and Q2 will not become 1. You can verify all these numbers. Starting from 4 zeros to 1001, we don't have any that particular combination where Q4 and Q2 will become 1. Only when it reaches to 9 and next value will become 1010, in that case only this NAND gate output will become 0. So whenever this NAND gate output becomes 0, automatically the contents of the flip flops will be cleared. So that means again counter will reach to 0000. Again it starts counting values step by step, one by one, and reach to 1001. 1001 means 9. And after this, whenever it becomes 1010, NAND gate output will become 0 and that will activate the clear signals. Clear bar, actually this is clear bar. So whenever this becomes 0, automatically all flip flops will get 0. So this is the way of constructing mod 10 counter. Similarly, if I want to construct mod 60, mod 80, whatever counter I want to construct, simple thing is take binary equivalent of that particular number. Suppose if I got number like this, after solving, after converting that decimal value into binary, I got this. So wherever, in which locations I got 1, those will be identified and those outputs will be connected to NAND gate, and whenever the counter reaches to this particular value, all the contents of the counter will be cleared. So this is the way of constructing mod counter.
For more updates, download the KL Radio app on Play Store or visit www.klradio.com.